Good evening, everyone. Good to see you tonight. Let's all stand together as we sing and worship.
I was buried beneath my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my tomb. Till I met you, yeah. And I was breathing but not alive, and all my failures I tried to hide. It was my tomb till I
seat just a moment. I'm glad he called my name and brought me to spiritual life. It's good to be in church on Wednesday night. Hope you've had a great day. If you've worked outside, you're glad to be inside, aren't you? And it's good to end the middle of the week on Wednesday being together in God's house, and we're going to spend some time in prayer. We're going to hear from God's word. First thing we're going to do tonight is we're going to vote in some new members. I forgot this last Wednesday, and so they told me to do that first thing tonight. So I'm not going to forget. So we're going to put some names on the screen here. Folks who have been saved and baptized, folks moving their membership to be a part of Crossway Baptist Church. We're so grateful that God is adding to our church. I need a motion that we accept these in the membership. and a second. All in favor, elbow to right hand. And let's rejoice and welcome these new members of Crossway. We're going to start tonight by just having a few moments of prayer. So those of you who are able tonight and would you come and join me here on your knees at this altar? And let's just bow before God tonight and lift up these prayer requests. While you're coming, let me share some things for us to pray about tonight. Our boys are in boys' camp, and God is speaking to them, and they're making decisions. And pray they'll have a strong week as they finish out. And then Friday, our middle schoolers, there's going to be 64 middle school students and workers, adults, students and adults going to Logan Valley for their retreat Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And so let's pray for Brother Kevin and those workers and pray for our middle school students. There are some of those in middle school who need to be saved, so we're going to pray for them tonight. Then the men's event, August the 19th, the Grand Slam men's event. I want to pray that God would use Sid Bream as he shares his testimony. And next Wednesday night, the next two Wednesday nights, August the 10th and the 17th, men, if you want to get here a little early, we're going to have a special time of prayer in the education wing over here in room A10. We're going to spend 30 minutes in prayer specifically for the men's event that God's Holy Ghost might move and men might be saved. So if you'll meet us there the next two Wednesday nights, we're going to pray for the men's event. And then, of course, we want to pray for those in our church who are sick, those in the hospital, those who've had surgery, and then those who've lost loved ones recently. We want to pray for them as well. I'm going to ask Brother Stan Bisher, if you would, brother, grab that mic right beside you, if you would, and if you'll make that hot for him. Brother Stan, would you voice a prayer for us tonight? Lift these things up, please.
Father, we do thank you for this day that you've given to us and just get away from the everyday activities of this week to come into your house and be surrounded by your word, Lord. We pray you be with Brother Vance tonight as he brings the word to us, Lord, that you would just use him mightily tonight, Lord, to speak to our hearts and give us what we stand in need of. Lord, we need you desperately. Lord, we thank you for the many blessings you bestowed upon us. And Lord, we are so gracious and thankful for what you do for us. And we pray, Lord, you continue to watch over our church and be with our camps as our young people are gone, Lord. We know there's some of them that need to be saved. And we pray as they go to this camp, Lord, they'd be surrounded by the world, get away from those things, Lord, that, Lord, just always confuse them. And they've centered around the word and the preaching, Lord, we'd see you do a mighty work there. So we lift those up to you. And Lord, as we get ready for this men's event, Lord, we pray that you would just be with that in a mighty way, Lord. What an opportunity we have to invite people that wouldn't come to church any other way, but they'll come to a men's activity, Lord, to hear somebody speak. So we pray that you do a mighty work there. Lord, we pray that you would just watch over the grounds and invite those that need to know Christ more than anything else. And Lord, we do lift up those in our midst, Lord, that are sick and going through surgery, those in the hospital, and especially, Lord, those in our congregation that have lost loved ones. Lord, we pray you just wrap your arms around them, Lord. They'd feel your comfort and your strength, Lord. We pray that you would just continue to be with them in a mighty way. Lord, we are so thankful for all that you do for us, how you bless us, how you take care of us, and most importantly, the great gift of salvation. So, Lord, we lift this night up to you that you would just continue to meet every need that's in this building. Lord, as we leave this place, we know we've been in your presence. We've been surrounded by your word, Lord, and you've revived us and encouraged us to go out in the world, Lord, and share our testimony. So, Lord, we lift this night up to you. Pray you'd have your will and your way that you might be glorified. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen. Why don't you stand right where you are and say hi to someone and welcome someone to church tonight.
We're ready.
seated.
Well, good evening. I'm going to invite you to grab your Bible, find Acts chapter 10 tonight, as we come to a message I've entitled Answering the Call. If you're finding Acts chapter 10, I just want to take an opportunity to express my tremendous gratitude to Pastor Eddie, to stand behind this sacred desk of this special church, to be able to open up God's word to God's people. It is a privilege and an honor. For years, I have championed and celebrated from afar what God has done in a unique way through Crossway Baptist Church, and tonight is no different. And I want to thank you for the opportunity to just open up God's word for us tonight in Acts chapter 10. But I want to be clear, I'm here to open up the word of God for us. You're not here to learn about me or to hear from me, and I'm not here to learn about you or hear from you. We're here to learn about the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the reason that we have gathered to worship. We just sang of the goodness of God because He alone is good. Amen? Amen. And with that in view tonight, I have a message entitled Answering the Call. Growing up, I remember the first phone we had in our home. It was a Harvest Gold rotary dial phone that we held in our kitchen. Any of you had a rotary dial phone? You know how long and how patient that each number taught you, especially if you had to dial a 9 or a 0. It went on forever. We actually upgraded it so that our phone that was there in the kitchen had one of those really, really long extension cords, so that we could sit at our small little dining table and talk on the phone. Talk about an upgrade. I remember one Christmas we received a gift, a life-changing gift. It was a Panasonic portable telephone. It was one where you actually could punch the numbers in, but the antenna kept extending that would make most truckers envious. It was long and tall, but it was the first phone that would allow us to walk through the house and talk on the phone. It was amazing. It was also amazing about how we would leave that phone there, and as soon as it rang, regardless of where you may be in the house, you ran like a mouse looking for a piece of cheese, trying to answer the phone before that last ring. It was always special. Some of you, your first phone wasn't a rotary dial phone or a portable phone in the house. It was a cell phone. It may have come in a form of a bag phone, a flip phone, one of those VCR-sized phones in the early 90s. It may have been one of the world-changing iPhones. We have all answered phone calls in our life. But you know what hasn't changed from the rotary dial phone to the phone that's probably in your pocket? The very simple point of how this phone connects one party to another party. One who's initiating a call and the other on the other end of the line who's answering the call. It hasn't changed in all these years. And hear me tonight, we are here to hear from God because God has a call on your life. I don't know what you walked in here tonight carrying, what burden, what opportunity the Lord has for you. But I know from God's word right here, He has a call for each man, each woman, each child that sits in this room tonight. And tonight, I want us to look in Acts chapter 10, where we see a picture of God using a man named Cornelius, to speak to him and give him a call on his life. There, Cornelius hears from the Lord and he responds, and in doing so, he teaches you and I how we are to answer the call of God on our life. Tonight, I want to show this to you from God's word, and I'm going to ask you to stand with me in the honor of reading God's word, beginning in Acts chapter 10, verse 1. We're only going to look at the first 8 verses, although the Lord knows how much I would desire to preach more than that. I know some of you need to get to choir practice, amen? Acts 10, verse 1, says, "There was a man in Caesarea named Cornelius, a centurion of what was called the Italian regiment. He was a devout man and feared God along with his whole household. He did many charitable deeds for the Jewish people and always prayed to God. The Bible says about 3 p.m, he distinctly saw a vision. In a vision, an angel of God who came in and said to him, Cornelius. Now notice with me what the Bible says. The Bible says, looking intently at him, he, Cornelius, became afraid and said, what is it, Lord? And the angel, the messenger, told him, your prayers and your acts of charity have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa and call for Simon, who is also named Peter. He is lodging with Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea. When the angel who spoke to him had gone, he called 2 of his household slaves and a devout soldier who was one of those attending him. After explaining everything to them, he sent them to Joppa. Father, I pray right now on behalf of us gathered by your word that you would give your spirit to us as the teacher, the counselor, the guide. Would you illuminate your word? Would you work in our hearts, revealing sin, revealing error, revealing opportunity, Lord? Will you work through your word? Will you work for me, through me, a man hidden by the cross and the mercy of Christ? And Lord, will you speak to us tonight by the power of God, through the word of God? We beg of you, O Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. Tonight, I want each of us to know that God calls men and women to accomplish his divine purpose. As we look at these 8 verses right here, what we see are 3 aspects of God calling men and women. 3 aspects of the call from God to you and I. The first aspect that we see is this: God's calling is convictional. Take your eyes with me back to verse 1, where we're introduced to a man named Cornelius. The Bible says this: there was a man in Caesarea named Cornelius. Some of you will see there within that very verse is an explanation. It gives us some additional details about who Cornelius is. It says he's a centurion in what is called the Italian regiment. Here's what we need to understand. Cornelius is not a common foot soldier. He's a centurion. He's been hand-selected by a Roman general because he is a man marked for his bravery. He is a man marked by his discipline. He has most likely served a minimum of 15 years in service and has been decorated and prized as a soldier. He has risen up among the ranks, and the other generals have looked upon this man named Cornelius, and they have elevated him to a position of leadership. That's what we see right here. But where all Roman soldiers were taught to fear and to worship Caesar alone, this man deviates from all the other Roman soldiers. What you need to understand is the Roman army was the strongest, largest, most military offensive army on the face of the planet at this time. And each of their soldiers had to sign on the line that they would only bend their knee to Caesar. But look with me at verse 2. Who is it that this man bends his knee to? Who is it that he fears and he worships? The Bible says that he was a devout man who feared God. Now, this is not a little g God. This is the God of the Bible, the one true God. And it says he feared God along with his whole household. He goes on in verse 2. It says he did many charitable deeds for the Jewish people, and he always prayed not to Caesar, but to God. Now hear me, the Bible doesn't tell us how this Roman centurion learned about the one true God. Perhaps it was in some business dealings that he dealt. Maybe it was because somebody went and knocked on his door and shared with him. Maybe he was just shopping at the local Caesarea Walmart where somebody told him, here is what the one true God has done for you. We don't know, but what we know right here is that this man learned about God and he came under conviction. The Bible says, don't miss that line, he feared God along with his whole household. Now, while the message of Jesus hadn't fully reached this Gentile soldier, he was able to distinguish between the little gods, the false gods, the no gods of this world, and the one true God. His eyes were able to see beyond the blinding darkness of this world. Which makes me want to ask this question tonight. What about you? Have you been in a spot in your life where your eyes have been spiritually opened to see the one true God of the Bible? Have you been able to see the Rock of Ages? Have your eyes been opened to see the Ancient of Days? Because the Bible says over and over that through his creation, through the church, God has made himself known so that all the world can see. But here in this passage, this man, Cornelius, has a spiritual understanding of who the one true God is, enough that it brings conviction in his life. I remember in my own life, I was a 9-year-old boy when God opened my eyes to see just who he was. Praise the Lord, I grew up in a Christian home. I grew up in a home, my parents are sitting right down here, members of the church, well before I was members of the church by that. They made it important for us to have spiritual conversations in our home. Listens, dads, listens, moms. The spiritual conversations you have with your kids as you walk, as you talk, as you drive, they're important. They were important in my life. But they also made sure that we had prioritized being at church. It was those Sunday school teachers, praise the Lord, who helped partner alongside families, partner alongside my parents to lay a foundation that would lead me as a 9-year-old boy on a March night where we would finish a family devotion. And there I came under conviction, personal conviction of my sin. As a 9-year-old boy, I knew rebellion. I knew that the only hope I had was Jesus. Amen? Amen. And there with my dad and my mom on both sides of me, we knelt beside my twin bed. And I prayed that night, repenting of my sins, believing Jesus Christ to be my Lord. He changed my life. He made me born again, is what the Bible says. I was a son of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Because what we see right here, what we recognize right here, is that when we come in our life to recognize the God of the Bible, it brings a conviction in us. God's call is convictional. But here's what I want you to understand. Here's what's important for you and important for you. When we received that call, it didn't initiate from me. It didn't initiate from you. It initiated from the God of heaven. It tells us in Ephesians that before the foundation of the world was even laid, God knew, God had a plan for you and I to save us of our sin. And his plan was always Jesus. In fact, while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. God had a plan. God had a purpose. It was initiated with him. But take your eyes back to verse 3 with me, because we see in this passage how God initiated the call with Cornelius. The Bible says about 3 in the afternoon, Cornelius distinctly saw a vision, an angel of God who came in and said to him, Cornelius. The Bible says, looking intently at him, he, Cornelius, became afraid and said, "What is it, Lord?" And the angel told him, "Your prayers and your acts of charity have come up as a memorial offering before God. Now send men to Joppa and call for Simon, who is also named Peter. He's lodging with Simon, a tanner, whose house is by the sea." Here's what we see, a man named Cornelius, a man with a broken past, a sordid history, came under conviction, and the Bible says that when he goes to pray at 3 in the afternoon, that the Lord speaks to him. The Lord initiates the call to him in such an undeniable way that this man, who is a decorated soldier, becomes afraid. He starts to cry like a baby because he sees the magnitude of the one calling him. Tonight, This man didn't get celebrated because he had supported charitable projects of the Jews. He didn't even get supported because he was doing a good job. No, he got the message of God because God's calling is convictional. Second, you need to know this. God's calling is directional. God's calling is directional. Here's what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid of that far too many Christians separate their conviction from God from the direction by God. The Lord convicts them, but they think they can just sit and soak. They can stay on the couch rather than get up and move. But hear me, when the Bible talks about how God moves, he talks about calling men and women, convicting men and women, and moving them in a direction. Y'all are students of God's word. I know this. This pulpit has been faithful to preach God's word. So think back with me, back to Genesis 12. Remember that man named Abram? He was there with his father and his father's land. And it was the God of the Bible, the same God right here, that called Abram out and said, "Leave me, leave your family, take you and your wife, and follow me to the land that I would show you." Abram believed by faith. Did he have all the directions laid out? No, he did not. He had direction from the Lord. He got up and moved. Think back just a few chapters later, or a few books of the Bible later, in Exodus chapter 3. The man named Moses, remember? Moses in Exodus chapter 3 has already been kicked out by his friends. His family, they've all rejected him. He's in an old sour crowd over on the other end. He's hiding in Midian. He's got all these sheep around him. Nobody wants to do anything with Moses. And God, through a burning bush, calls out to him. Moses first says, hey, not me. I'm not gifted. I can't go back to Pharaoh's house. Not me. And the Lord says, no, it's exactly you. God's calling was to direct Moses to be that deliverer. That's what God's calling does to all of the disciples. In the New Testament, he may call them to leave their fishing net, to walk out of their tax collecting booth, but it was always to get up and move. It was directional. Here's why I want you to know this. We live in a culture marked by the paralysis of analysis. Everyone wants to search to spreadsheet and to social media what they think God is telling them to do before they make a move. They want to have all the details laid out. They want to know all of it before they ever take a step of faith. But is that what faith looks like? Is faith when you have all the details worked out? Or is faith stepping in obedience to the one who is calling you, follow me? That's what we see right here. I want you to know real faith, godly faith, biblical faith is not only being receptive to the Lord's direction in your life, but it is trusting the Lord to deal with the consequences that he is calling you into. It's exactly what we've seen in our pastor. I stand before you tonight because our pastor lives this out. I'll never forget the day I received the phone call from Pastor Eddie to pray about coming to Crossway Baptist Church. Initially, we had some conversations that pertained to both of our churches. And finally, in a course of conversation as it shifted, he said to me, "I'm embarrassed to ask you this, but would you and Amy pray about coming to be the executive pastor at Crossway Baptist?" He shared with me how he had been praying for some time and how the Lord kept placing me on his heart and how he was quick to dismiss it. Never thought I would be coming here. Our church was growing. We were seeing a unique move of God. But he came down and he said, if he didn't ask, he would be disobedient. Honestly, can I give y'all some, Pastor, you can close your ears here. Can I give you some inside information? It was the lousiest sales job you'd ever heard in your life. It was bad. There was no pomp, no circumstance, no dog and pony show. There was nothing. Instead, what we had is a man with humility, with a tenderness. He wasn't boasting in himself. He was boasting on the Lord. He was bragging on y'all. He said, we're seeing God move here. We're seeing God move in some unique and divine ways that we should pause right now and just celebrate the Lord. Amen. Y'all in service on Sunday? You saw people getting saved on Sunday in the service. Dead people walking into the room, spiritually alive, eternally alive, because Jesus is present here. Amen. That's what we're seeing right here. And when Pastor was sharing with me, he wasn't bragging on him at all. You'd be proud of him. And I was honored by him, that he would think enough of me to care enough for you to be obedient to the Lord, to say, we believe God is doing something here. But I told you he was a lousy salesman. So when I went home that night, Amy was pulling supper out of the oven. That's what we call it, supper. She was pulling supper out of the oven. She asked about my day. I casually mentioned it to her, and her words, Amy, her words were, yeah, right, I don't see that happening. And for the next 3 days, we didn't even talk about it. Separately, we prayed, but we didn't have a conversation. We were driving down the road. It came up in conversation, and as it did, we looked over at one another, and we said, there's something different about this, isn't there? There's something different, not because of anything we've experienced in the past, because honestly, we'd had churches, 5 or 6 or 7 churches a year that had contacted me, asking would I consider, pray about coming to be a senior pastor at their church. It was always an easy no. We felt like the Lord had us in the spot for the church that we planted. We were planning on giving the next 30 years of our life there. We were making inroads in the community. We're seeing God do this. Lord, why would you take us away from this? It had always been an easy no. We were not in want. We were satisfied, and we were just happy to do ministry. But it was different because the Spirit of God was calling us. We committed to a season of prayer and fasting. No one knew but the two of us and Pastor Eddie. And in doing so, I feel pretty comfortable in my own skin. I know how God's kind of wired me. And in this time, I was just praying. I'm saying, Lord, this is what my concerns are. This is what I want to lay before you. And there were a series of you could call them non-negotiables. You could call it philosophy of ministry. You could call it, this isn't my first rodeo. But these were the things that I knew that we just had to be on the same page about if it was ever going to work, if God was ever going to be in this. And I wrote them down privately in my journal. No one had read them. Amy didn't even read them, but I shared them with her. We finally sat down with Pastor Eddie and Miss Tess. And as we're talking, ladies and gentlemen, it was like he read them verbatim. Every single one of them in order. It was like he had just taken my notes and read them. And he's sharing his heart with me. And it just was the clearest call that we had ever had in our life that God was in this. Because what we see in this passage is that our pastor didn't sit on the sideline and say, well, I just don't think it will happen. He understood the direction of God's call in your life, my life tonight. That's exactly what we see, that God's calling is not only convictional, it gets us here, but God's calling is directional. It moves his people into action. But there's a third element that we see out of this passage, and it is this, that God's calling is personal. take your eyes back here to verse 5, and I want you to see with me who Cornelius is to go reach. Be students of God's word. Ask questions of his word. Who in this passage is Cornelius to go after? Notice with me, it's not John, it's not Paul, it's not Tom, Dick, or Harry. No, the Bible says right here, he's to go after Peter, Simon Peter. Just read verse 5 with me. It says, now send men to Joppa and call for Simon, who was also named Peter. He is lodging with Simon, a tanner. So let's be clear, let's not get our Simons mixed up. They've got Simon Peter and Simon the tanner, and it gives him very explicit instruction about where Peter is located. Now, we live in a day and age where we've got GPS in our cars or on our phones or somewhere around. We've got Find My iPhone, Life 360. But this was before all of that. And what we see is that God knew exactly where Peter was located because the call on Peter's life was personal. God had a plan for him, a purpose for his life. 35 miles away from where they are located right now with Cornelius, there was Peter, empowered by the Holy Spirit, and God was sending men to do what he never imagined. If I could tell you and move through this passage, we would see how this is a life-defining, church-redefining, cultural mission shift moment of all, because in this moment, Peter comes and he's bringing for the first time the gospel of Jesus Christ beyond the Jews to all the Gentiles. Acts 1:8 is being fulfilled in this very passage right here. But in this passage, ladies and gentlemen, who may have walked in here and said, well, God could never use me. God knows my past. He understands my problems, but he would never call me like he called Peter here. Peter was unique. I want you to know Peter was a man with problems. He had a messed up past. He was the one who cut off a man's ear. He denied the Lord 3 times, and yet he's the very one that God's going to use to bend the mission so that every tribe, every tongue, every nation will hear the message of who Jesus is. Peter was called to bring the message to Cornelius' house, and today that same message has been brought to your house. Jesus alone saves. Amen. Yet tonight, across this room, I believe that what we have taking place is an Acts 10 moment where God is personally calling men and women to accomplish his divine mission. Tonight, he's not using a rotary dial phone, an antenna phone, or a cell phone. He's using a meager man right here to preach the word of God to the people of God so that you can listen to the Spirit of God. He's moving you tonight to answer the call. He's convicting you and calling you forth. And tonight, I'm going to put out the call to you. You may not know what the future looks like. You may be like Abraham right there. God's calling you out. You don't know where he's calling you, but you just sense in your soul that he's moving in your life right now. And tonight, the first step is a step of direction. It's a step in faith to say, Lord, will you use me? Will you show me the way? Will you get up and direct me to where you want me to go? Some of you tonight are just like Moses. Your issue isn't that God's called and you haven't heard it. It's that inside you're saying, no, you can't use me. You're resistant to the call of God tonight. Would you allow the Spirit of God to break that? Would you move forward? Would you just yield your life tonight? Men, we need you. We need you over the next few weeks to reach out to other men with an invitation to say, come join us for our Grand Slam event on August 19th. You realize you've got a home run ball sitting on the tee. Actually, let me say this. You got a Grand Slam ball sitting on the tee. All you have to do is swing it at that coworker, that neighbor, that guy filling up the gas next to you. Would you be courageous enough to answer the call and extend an invitation to potentially change his life and the generation of those behind him. Would you be that man? Some of you tonight understand, as you look across our church on a Sunday morning, we've got young families coming out of the woodwork. We got a new building. Pastor, I think we may have to double the size of it. We've got young families coming out of the woodwork. And some of you have looked across to our nation and said, our problems in our nation, what are the solution? I could tell you the solution for the problem of our nation. It's sitting in this room right here. Would you be willing to lean in to serve in our children's ministry and our student ministry for all of these families that are coming in? You might say, hey, I don't even know how to get involved. Can I be honest with you? I haven't been here long enough to tell you how to get involved, but we'll find out together. It's about answering the call. And yet tonight, some of you are sitting here and the personal call that comes into your heart is not yet a call to serve. It's not yet a call to go. It's a call to surrender. Because you've never come to a spot to truly surrender your life to Jesus Christ. You're sitting here tonight, bound in your sin, tight in your turmoil. And I'm telling you, there is one who has saved me from the muck and mire of this world, and he has given his life to save you. He is calling you tonight. Come, trust me. Repent of your sins. Allow me to be your Lord and Savior. It's a personal call to salvation. Repent. Place your faith in Jesus Christ. It's a call that maybe you've sat here on a Wednesday night many nights before, but tonight's different because the Spirit of God is doing something in your soul that's undeniable, unquenchable. He's prompting and moving you because the call of God isn't a rotary phone. It's the Spirit of God moving to your very heart, and you're yielding tonight to say, yes, Lord Jesus, I repent of my sins, and I trust you alone to be the Savior of my life. God's call is for us to answer tonight because his call is convictional. His call is directional. And his call, ladies and gentlemen, is personal. I'm going to ask you to stand with me. Tonight, I'm going to conclude by praying for us. But I'm going to conclude by giving you an opportunity to respond to the Lord tonight. It may be that you're stepping out tonight knowing that the Lord is directing you. And you may not know what that looks like. I'm going to just ask our staff if it's appropriate for you all to be down here, if you've got some deacons here as well. And you would just simply say, coming to these men, I sense that God is calling me into the unknown that I don't know. Would you pray for me tonight? And these godly men that love you dearly will pray for you. Perhaps tonight, it's the call of salvation that you have never bent your knee. And tonight is the night that the Lord is moving in your life. And so as I come and conclude us with a word of prayer, these men will be up here and you move. You respond. You come after this service, and they will care, shepherd, and pastor your souls because they love you. God's calling us tonight. O Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. Creation broke forth at your will. The stars are aligned and held in place by your authority. The mountains bend at your beckoning. And yet you have chosen men and women like us with faults and failures, to be the instruments that take your mission around the world. And so, Father, tonight I ask that you would pour out your Spirit, convicting and calling men and women. I pray tonight that they would have the courage to come to this altar and just simply yield in faith and surrender and say, I don't know what the future holds, but I know the one who holds the future. Lord, you're glorious. You're mighty. And through the work of Jesus Christ, we know hope and salvation. And so I come tonight feeble, praying with the power of the Spirit of God through the authority of the Son who gave his life as a purchase for us. Lord, will you work and move in our church? We pray this now in Jesus' name. Amen. You come tonight. Give those around you a good hand.